我在05年、06年，我还在北艺大服务的时候，就有机会透过师长，就认识这一位很幽默、很风趣、很随和的一位学者。那一个因缘机会，他又找我一年来到中国艺大服务。那我很高兴，说我到中国艺大之后，继续有这样一位很好的一个亦师亦友的一个伙伴。好，所以。 很多人都说，这个关教授很难相处，但也许是我跟他的一些机缘啊。我就我一直觉得他是一个非常随和的人。好，那他等一下是会跟我们分享一些，我也不知道是什么东西哦，因为题目又有点变化。因为那个 I was just learned that Professor Guang will give us a full English talk。 So I think I should also give him, make him an introduction in English. Professor Guang, he is very fun to be with. He really cracks me up. Oh, he is passionate and kind every day. As he just told me, he is very proud of being the godfather of PBL, popular learning. So I think I should say a few words to honor and praise him. He is tough. He is a gem. He is an S. He is the best of the best. He is the top of the top. He is A number one. He is one in the mirror. He is a needle in the haystack. He is a man we can do without. He is not only an expert in the field in problem learning, he is also a specialist in bacterial biology research. He is as solid as a rock. He is as stable as can be. Here he is. Today he will talk about what have I learned from doing vascular biology research while establishing my his academic career. Okay, let's give him a big hand.
All right, well, thank you very much. And that was supposed to be a surprise because, first of all, the title is not what you see. Secondly, I'm going to speak in English all the way. And this is something I got the permission, though, right? And I thought if we are the world-class university, and if our university asks us to have an all-English course, I think we should start any possible way to use English. Then we will improve better in English. That's the way I see it. So I'm going to set an example because I dare to do many things that other people doesn't dare to. And that's what he said. That's why some people hate me, but some people love me. So I don't mind because that's life. Some people hate you, some people love you. That's reality. Don't expect anybody love you. Everybody loves you. Okay, so that's the way. And don't expect you make everything successful when you pick up a project as a graduate student or as a teacher, because your project may fail you all the time. Don't think you publish a paper, the paper got accepted, because you may be lucky, got accepted, you know, 3 out of 10. So that's what I'm gonna tell you today. And that's why I choose this topic, because I know when I come here, and we are in purpose of celebrating the 500, top 500, we're entering that. So that's the purpose. We are not having an international symposium to tell the world we are within the 500. We are within ourselves. And therefore, I dare to say anything I want. And I'll be responsible for what I said, because in there, I will make some remark. Unfortunately, the VIP before me, he has to leave. The VIP before me and have to leave. Looks like after my talk, I have to leave too. I don't have to stay to listen to anybody else. And that's the thing I never do. I always stay all the way in a meeting that I participated. That's what I call respect. Respect other people, other speakers. All right. Well, this is what we do. Postgraduate university that I served. I served university. I want you to look at down there. This is what we are here. We are 453rd, and according to this. But if you go to QS, we are outside 700, China Medical University. But where I come from as a graduate student, as a teaching assistant, University of Pennsylvania, UPenn. Okay, the one of the top ones, and number 12. And I served McMaster for 30 years. That's where the PBL originated, quite original ones. Where, talking about cardiovascular, I got the Heart Foundation Fellowship Award for straight 15 years. Every 3 years you apply nationally, compete, and I got it all the time, the whole Canada. And that's how we survive. I don't get money from university. My salary paid by the foundation because I excel in research. And I got an award as a young investigator award in Canadian Hypertension Society. That's national as well. And of course, all my time at McMaster University from the very low rank to full professor in 8 years. Here we talk about 5, 6, 9. 8 years from the lowest to top. And I also got emeritus professor. That's a prestigious name. That means after you retire, they give you honorary professor, the name. Because otherwise, when you retire, you retire. You're no longer professor. So I am retiring next year, January. I wonder whether I will be named emeritus professor at this university. I wonder. Then I went to University of Hong Kong, which ranked number 23, the first in Asia, where I was the structural chair, 讲座教授, in physiology. So I carry a lot of glories, and I come here. And I come here to be the director, if you don't know already, of Center for Faculty Development. So I don't do much teaching of students. So many graduate students may not know me. Many undergraduate may not know me. But all the teachers know me because I teach them. Well, I want to give you the message, what I've learned. The first thing I learned throughout my research career is the teamwork. And you can see the team I was belong to at in Canada, Smooth Muscle Research Group. That was formed in 1976 after I graduated with my PhD from UPenn. And I joined McMaster University. This is the group I joined. And you will see, those circles I circled, those are the first member at university. And this is the boss, okay, very famous in pharmacology, Professor Daniel. So I went there and helped him. And these are students, and only this, me, and this are faculty. So four of us, we build up the Smooth Muscle Research Group that turned out to be the top in the world for study smooth muscle. I hope you know what smooth muscle is. It's all over your body. So I was responsible for the smooth muscle in blood vessels because blood vessels contain smooth muscle. And the important thing is that you can see one thing different from any of us. Our research group here. Our group was the international ones. We have those from Japan. Even this professor, he did a postdoc in my lab. Now he's the professor, okay, in Showa University. And many of them like that. And from India, and from Netherlands, from Russia, and from France, and from Germany, and from many other places, Hong Kong, and so on. We are an international group. We can say we are internationalized there. And over there, you can hear any kind of English. Some English, if you go there, you don't even know what they are talking about because they carry so heavy accent there. But we do. We're international people. Doesn't matter how you pronounce it, I can manage it. because even in Hong Kong, I have a Russian technician who was in Moscow, like NIH. He was the person responsible for it. But at that time, Russia was in big trouble. So I took him to Hong Kong, and he became my assistant. My goodness. When he speaks, nobody understands in Hong Kong about what he talks about. Only I manage with time. Oh, but anyway, I think importance is internationalization, especially in research. And that's what our international guy went. Okay. That's what he's supposed to help, to make us more internationalized. That's why we need a lot of foreign professors, foreign students, including that person there, okay, to help us to make it more international. To help us making more international means, you have to be able to learn how to think like other people in different type of world. You don't think as a Taiwanese. You have to think on the other people's point of view. But I find out when we do international things, we think only as a Taiwanese. We don't consider other people. So you have to follow mine. And you don't get internationalization that way. You have to use their language. You have to learn to use language. Don't be afraid. Language, there's only one way to learn language. Use it. Use it. Write it. Talk about it. All right, so that's the environment I grew up for more than 30 years. Okay. The other is, you have such a large group with different opinion, different way of thinking, then it helps you to converge different opinion, which you can integrate things into a more organized way because they are all non-organized. And I think that's what research is. You get information from very different places. Even in vascular biology, you can use different method, different approach. But you have to use all this information in your brain and integrate it. So integration is important. And integration, do we know how to do integration? If you think only one way, that's the only way you know. You don't know how to change the direction a bit, you solve the problem. But many of us, when we make hypothesis, only hypothesis we see. You don't think about others. That's the difficulty when you do research as a graduate student. And your teacher should be responsible for that. Because life by itself, by nature, is integrative. Your whole life. You're living. Life is for living. When you live your life, you live integrated way. You face many different situations. You see many people. And you have to learn how to integrate all the signal coming into your mind. And that is important. Otherwise, if you think only one way, you will be a reductionist. You will not be a constructivist. If you are not a constructivist, you're very simple-minded. You won't do a good research. So I try to this related to why I was attracted to problem-based learning at McMaster University. Because using problem-based learning, PBL, is the way we learn it integratively. I've been learning that all my graduate life integrative way. And therefore, I understand integration. I was even the chair in physiology, where I never studied a book on physiology. I don't have a degree in physiology, but University of Hong Kong, the top university in Asia, invite me to be the chair of that department, and I manage very well. And that is why, because you have to learn how to integrate it. You integrate your life, you integrate your work. Well, this is cardiovascular system. You do have a pumping heart with a central function, but you do have many other different type of blood vessels. Like can be vein, can be artery, can be resistant blood vessel, can be capillaries. There are many. Blood vessel is not one thing. There are many different things. When they got diseased, it can be very large and become dysfunction. So large doesn't mean it's good. Just like what Professor Xu said, you got a lot of money in the bank, but you may be dying, you couldn't use the money there, all right? So, and then you can go down from the organ level into tissue level, get all the way down into even cellular level and subcellular level. So there are many levels of approach in research you can do. I wonder how many people these days now learn how to use electron micrograph. It's a dying discipline. Our anatomy department here, I wonder if anybody knows how to do this. I don't know how to do it, but I watch my friend, we collaborate, do it. I can interpret any electron micrograph you show me. I can tell you the story about that. But I don't have to be major in that. Because you do it enough and you learn from it. All right, when you cut the blood vessel cross-sectionally, you will find our blood vessel is not just an empty tube. It contains many different layers. Different layer with the function of bring the oxygen, bring the nutrition, bring the signaling molecules all over the body, all these tissues, we call it infusion, perfusion. But when it goes, it has a pressure. The pressure acts on it, stretch it. And the previous speaker said that, okay, the very early ones. But then their control is so important because all over the body. So therefore, the way blood vessels contract and relax, open up the lumen diameter, is critically for your health. Go too much, you may break the blood vessel, then you may get a stroke, okay? And or occlusive, it doesn't have blood go through, you may have a heart attack. And so regulation of this is very important. That's what we study in blood vessel. But that, you don't just study this small muscle itself. But even though small muscle have a myogenic control, the way it controls by itself in response to stress. But it also affected by hormone in the blood that come from various part of blood of the body. And it also controlled by the nerve, by the nerve system, we call it neural effector control of the blood vessel. So it is a complicated matter by itself as an organ. It has a neurogenic, hormonal, and myogenic control. Three aspects at different level. And when you look at Nobel Prize given to the person who find out nitric oxide being released here, and you find out the last 3 years, people talk about adventitia, fibroblasts, and adipocyte, even fat around the blood vessel, may send out signaling molecule, which maybe have something to do with obesity. And with all that, imagine, just a single tube that will keep your whole life very busy. And that's what I've been studying all my life. Well, in order to integrate, you got to have a multiplicity. And blood vessel is an organ with a multiple layers, multiple cells. Indeed, it will, because you got so many different cells, it also gives diversity. So you know, blood vessel is not just like what we learned before, a tube, muscle tube. It contains endothelial cells, which was originally thought very inert, but it's no longer inert. It's very active. It releases so many different things. Just like nowadays, people think the fat around the blood vessel is inert because it just formed a cushion with its neighboring tissues, but it's not. It also regulates the blood vessel itself from inside and from outside itself. So this has to be integrated, as I said in the previous slide as well, that only through very close integration then it can function properly. And that is what I said about collectively. They bring about functional complexity at higher level. So we are higher level. Mammals are higher level, and the blood vessel itself is a higher level organ by itself. We have to understand not just one single thing. So I don't mind the President's Award you will not be able to get previously, because that's only one thing you try to memorize. Who cares? Who cares? You have to understand how things are integrated, not what is IKK mean. My goodness, that's remember. That's remembering. That's nothing. I tried to tell in front of him, but I didn't have the heart of saying so. Good research and high education needs diversity. If you don't diverge, you only look at one thing. Forget it. You won't go too far. Because diversity makes you think more from different angles. And as you manage it, you become efficient. But efficiency is not the only thing. It has to be effective. If you get things done efficiently, but not effective, it's no use. It's just like you're involved in teaching. You give lectures, but students never learn. So you teach, students don't learn. It's not effective. But when you do PBL, people say, you use a lot of time, waste a lot of time. But that's effective, maybe not efficient. But for education, effectiveness is much more important. That's why I also put this in the form of fundamental basis for PBL. Now, the pedagogy, it is an innovative approach. It is the most accepted, most effective, innovative approach for self-directed learning. Self-direct learning is so important because all my life when I study, I was self-directed. I go to look for information. I check things out. I discuss with the supervisor. He doesn't have to feed me with all the information. I do it myself because that's my project. So I think the message to the graduate student here, you have to be able to do it self-directedly. 自主性. And that's only way you can excel. I say only way. Otherwise, you have to rely on somebody famous to get you up, not on your own. Well, organs can get aged. We talk about aging. So aging because of a lot of injury. So we talk about free radicals because free radical give injury. Free radical injury cause inflammation as well. Inflammation eventually lead tissue damage, apoptosis. Then disease formed, aging formed, and so on and so forth. So we know when blood vessel is dysfunctional, whether it's due to aging, environmental contamination, obesity, cancer, or gender, men and women never be equal. Okay, so therefore in cardiovascular side, and you can see many diseases can be formed as you go old, as you got obese. There are so many different things. That's what I said. Blood vessel. Study of blood vessel keep you employed for several generations. So many things has not been resolved. I think that's very important. We have to recognize diversity because the organ itself is diverse. The approach is diverse. So possibility is also very diverse. Today we also talk about failure at one time, didn't we? I said honorable failure. Now in your life, everybody's life, in your marriage, in your examination scores, in your love life, every day you're bound to fail on something, at least you feel fail. And that could be in your career as well. All right, so failure, remember, is not something you should be afraid of. All my life, I failed many times. In my experiment, I got frustrated. Experiment did not work, including my students' experiment. Okay. Then you look at it, actually may not be that bad. First, you have to say, what kind of failure is that? If that's honorable failure, it's okay. What do you mean by honorable failure? That means it's an honest try. Even you tried, you fail, it's honorable failure. But some people don't even try. Some people try different sneaky way or non-ethical way. Even that they fail. If they don't do the right way, that's incompetent failure, we call it. Incompetent failure. So I'm saying honorable failure, we should face it, we should understand it, we should accept that. Because there are so many successful things that occur after a few honorable failures because you're willing to try harder. and which occurred to me many times. And many times I thought this is the wrong way. This is not the data we found. And then you look into it, you find another way. It helped you explain something else. It failed because of their reason they failed. The reason is not that what you think originally. And therefore, you found a new way of handling things. And that's why when we do problem-based learning, unlike the traditional learning, traditional thing, once you do the examination, you fail. That mark is gone. They don't let you have another chance. But in PBL, we let students make mistakes because they learn from mistakes. If you don't let them make mistakes, like the traditional teaching, they will not be able to face the mistake they made. I think they make a lot of difference. Because you let them make mistakes, they will correct it. They realize they will do that. But if you forcefully and blame them for the mistakes, they will resist. Like Zhongyida, you don't even know YKK, your level is very low. They don't allow you to make mistakes. Make mistakes is shameful. It's not the right thing to do. I don't like that. Everybody make mistakes. Another way, throughout my research, I learned how to problem solve. You solve the problem within the problem. Because first you have to explore them. Our problem in Taiwan, in many others, including politics, including administration, including study, is we try to jump to problem solving. Whatever that is, okay, I want to know the answer. Knowing standard answer is a form of problem solving. So problem solving sometimes are good words, sometimes not good words. Because in Taiwan, students, they do gongbi. You heard about it, common notes. That is very unique. You don't see any place else. Not in Japan, not in Hong Kong, not in mainland China. Xie gongbi, write down the common notes, is a problem solving. Is the result of problem solving. They don't want to learn more. As long as they copy whatever professor says and make a book out of it, and exam only look at that, they don't learn even more. But here, you allow them. Here, even some teachers say, oh, you have this gongbi, let me see if that's good. You even encourage them. So we said, no. Explore the problem first before you solve it. If you explore the problem, you understand. You do the reasoning. Then through reasoning, you solve your problem. There are steps we have to do. So you cannot 急功近利. And that's our problem also in Taiwan. We want to be successful in one trial. And therefore, we take any ways to reach that without understanding what it takes underneath to be successful. So this is another lesson I have learned. You can see problem solving, in order for me to do problem solving in cardiovascular field over the past 30 some years, I do contractility, I use pharmacological tools, I use digital imaging to look at calcium on on cells as well as single cell, one cell, looking at the calcium distribution. I use target radiation, measure molecular weight. How many of you know that? Okay, radioligand binding for receptors for ion transport. I even use MMR, sodium MMR in Japan. I use ESR to measure membrane fluidity interaction with drugs. Now, if I were not to have my multiple background with theoretical chemistry, physical chemistry, quantum chemistry, and all that, I would not think about using these methods. And that's why multiplicity, diversity helps you think better. I use whole tissue, isolated cell. I just don't use isolated cell and get my conclusion all over the world about one mechanism. you have to use isolated cell, culture cell, single cell, subcellular membrane, and the whole tissue. Finally, you have to use to the functional state. Because whatever you studied, because there's no meaning of function, forget it. You're wasting your time. Because you're not studying for the sake of function. You're studying for the sake of certain molecules. What's the use? What's the function? I don't know. That's not the medical, biomedical science approach. And therefore, we study at all various levels. My research used to be focused on calcium, which center around. When drug interact with cell, what does it change into the calcium? If calcium is changed, is it changing calcium channels, or changing calcium pumps, or changing sodium calcium exchange? And how does calcium lead to such a change? Through excessive contraction, or through many other calcium-dependent mechanisms. And that's how it derived into calcium imaging studies. That's how they derive into receptor study, because this receptor uses different pool of calcium. That's how it goes to this pathological study. I got the awards in Hypertension Society for calcium dysfunction theory. And that's how I link with hypertension, blood vessel. And I was trained in chemistry, so I love molecules. I love to see molecule shape and the receptor side, receptor interaction, and how they make a difference in terms of molecules' behavior. So naturally, I go into natural products, and that also related to Chinese medicine. That's how I do it. Okay, that requires, again, diversity and multiple thinking, critical thinking. And internationalization also represents the multiplicity. Because you interact with different people, and you know their culture, you know their way of thinking, you collaborate them, you even develop leadership among them, or see the leadership, how they lead people, how they manage people. You make friends with them. That brings up your visibility. In Taiwan, you don't go out, nobody know about you except limited people in Taiwan, in your field. When we get promotion, we ask international people to judge us. We don't send out to my friends in other university in Taiwan. We send out internationally, five names. You want to promote a professor? Yeah, give us five names in this field and let them judge you whether you are at that level. And that's what we do. And through that, you do lifelong learning. You have to learn all the time. Okay, that represents your professional growth. That builds up your confidence. And of course, being able to do internationalization and with all the different people, you cultivate your culture enhancement. I think that's also very important when how you work internationally, because we are no longer working by ourselves. Especially in Taiwan, small island like this, you have to interact with people around you in order to survive. I tell you, survive, okay? Through cultural enhancement, internationalization. So therefore, we all know we are in a global village, and that's the concept we must develop in research and in our everyday living. How I did it, so all three stages. At McMaster, at Hong Kong U, University of Hong Kong, and China Medical University. Now those in Chinese you can read, I don't want to describe it further. But the way to do it is get involved. Get involved in various different professional associations. Get involved in some international meetings. Go out and visit. Invite people in if you have money in a position. If not, you go out to meet people. Okay, you take leadership, organize something, create something, not just follow, create, be leader. Okay, of course, our president say we never want to be a leader, we want to be the second, that's fine. But at least the second, not the third, not the last. Only when you do so, then you got the international visibility. Then you can do a lot of different things. If we only do ourselves, we call it 闭门造车. You don't go too far. 87 is the first time, 1987, is the first time I visit China and acquainted with this person. 背后是颐和园 okay. And this person, of course, he's powerful. And with him, we started the first this cross-strait conference, cardiovascular sciences, is still go on today. Still go on today. Many people know. Okay. This is the first time I was representing Hong Kong, Lin Maochun representing Chengda, and this representing Xieheyida. And three of us formed this meeting and go on for a long, long time already. And of course, after so many years,I do the same. Coming to this university, not knowing who I will collaborate with, not knowing what other system we got, cardiovascular system, I establish vascular biology research group. Every year we have an international meeting. Every year. And you can see, you can see every time I got at least five countries people coming together.Recently, we don't have much fun, so I wrote to my friends. These are all my friends. As you can see, some of them you have seen it in the previous, in the previous picture, right? This Japanese, okay, several other people. We've become long-term friends for over two decades. And they support me. They say, it's okay. I will come. Because I told them I will not be able to support your travel anymore because our university doesn't give me money.And they all come on their own money. I still can get so many people attending this meeting because they come for me. One of the professors here, he said, how did you get so many people? We don't have so much money. They're all from USA, from Hong Kong, and many other places. I said, no, it doesn't cost me anything because they come to support me as a person. They don't need money.Okay, the other one, I'm finished soon. Here, because I said I do natural product all along, even when I was in Canada before I come here, already many years. If I were in University of Hong Kong, I would have been the director of Chinese medicine, School of Chinese Medicine, by left. Now here, with this in mind, many of theI'm a pharmacologist, well, many of the drugs I use, they are all related to cardiovascular site. And these are a name, a list of the name of the thing that I use, the extract that I use. All the way earliest in 1986 when I started to use Tian Qi and Ringsheng, okay. Then as time goes on, I visit China almost every year,interact with them and bring in some new drugs. And even Fen Fang Ji Jian itself, I got 30 publications out of it. Okay, altogether I have 64 people just on this. And then recently, those from Japanese collaborator because they can also isolate purify compound. And they are very much interested in Chinese medicine. And because all these medicine are also working on blood pressure, lower the blood pressure.Including the one from Xinjiang, Du Zhong, we all know about it. People thought previously it was acting on kidney because according to Chinese medicine, that's Du Sen, okay? But I found out, the first paper I found out is diluted blood vessel in a nitric oxide dependent way. And that was the first paper we found out, and that should be the main mechanism because as going to the blood, it dilated the blood vessel.Then resistance of the blood also dropped. The same thing with Ziwujia. Ziwujia in North America is very common. They call it Siberian ginseng. It's not ginseng at all. That's Ziwujia. And Ziwujia also has this kind of property. That the most potent one is Luo Bu Ma from Xinjiang. It's very long lasting. It has a lot of potential, which I'm still studying. But I don't get the graduate student here.So I cannot study a lot of them, but I go to Malaysia to get my graduate students. So I work with them. We do Skype, you know, and we showed the data and discussed some methodology. So nowadays, technology can cross the nation. You can do it every day to discuss research with your student so many miles away. And it worked equally well. We just recently published a paper on it. All right, so it's about time. My last say is, in the West, I've been regarded as an award-winning established researcher in vascular biology, but in Taiwan, not many people know about my research expertise in vascular biology, for which I was professionally trained. That's true. Many people thought of me as a PBL guy. But my reputation in vascular biology internationally is better than PBL. Rather, I have been well noted here for my expertise in PBL and medical education. That's why I was put in this position as a faculty development. But I also excel, because I can always learn, I can always do on my own. I don't need to be trained. I never have any training in medical education, but I still be able to do faculty development. How? Learn it when you need it. That is the spirit of PBL. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Guan, for your insight or talk. I think it should be the time to end this speech, right?
Maybe.
Yeah, okay. Okay, thank you.
IMG from Kaohsiung Tangeng Yiye.
And you are
Ken. Thank you for your excellent and professional lecture. I have one question. According to your lecture, we learn the diversity for research approach. However, our teacher also tell us that because we have the limit of time and strength, so we should focus in one or two research that would give more successful and deep investigation. So how could we do?
Your teacher is definitely correct. I would do the same thing. Because when you are a student, you better focus on one thing. I was not a student, I was an investigator. I should be able to consider many different things, and so that you can integrate them. But your student is during the training. Okay, when I have a student, of course, they have to be focused. But I also, every Monday we have a meeting. Many other people's students also come to our laboratory, we share. And through such a discussion, there's a lot of learning happening, because the people with other expertise will question different things, so make you think. So my students learn a lot, integration and diversity from research meeting. But project, I want you to focus. Project, you want to focus. But approach, I want you to have a diversity.
Yeah, I understand what you say. We know that you are genius, but not everyone genius.
Learn PBL, you'll be a genius.
It's time to take a break. Yeah. You will have chance to chat with Professor Guan. You are encouraged to talk with him later. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Guan, outstanding talk. So we also have the honorable Super Neo for Dr. Guan. So it's
那接下来就是我们荣幸请到我们中央大学附设医院的张坤正张主任。那张主任是我们心脏内科的主任哦。那他在医学方面还有心脏方面都是一个专家。那很荣幸的请他来这边帮我们介绍我们今天的实例。谢谢黄所长，各位老师、各位同学。那我想我今天非常荣幸来跟大家介绍我们的这个讲者叶汉根医师。那叶医师事实上是我多年前的老友了。 我们以前在共同在这个高雄长庚的时候打拼啊，那叶医师的专长是做心导管的，他也救了不少心肌梗塞的病人。但是呢，他身为一个临床医师，他也做基础的研究，而且做得非常好啊。他的这个论文的发表呢，是高雄长庚所有的医生哦，所有的医生里面第一名，啊，有非常的这个很多很好的paper发表。 那他今天来跟我们分享他的研究，也就是他的专长，他是做心导管嘛。那心导管就是要这个打通冠状动脉。那他可以从一个临床医师呢，除了给病人提供这样的治疗，那他也进一步做基础的研究，所以他从临床到 bench， 然后从 bench 又到 clinical， 整个连在一起。那请大家啊，以热烈的掌声来欢迎叶医师的演讲。
谢谢张医师的好朋友的介绍。那么各位前辈、各位先进，还有我的好朋友，还有各位同学，大家好，午安。就讲我的 topic 前，其实我还是要讲一句话。那么刚刚关教授所演讲的，其实给我们非常非常的一个就研究方面一个方向。所以如何做研究，其实刚刚我讲的跟问的关教授，其实跟大家唱对台而已。事实上，我内心都200%赞同他的讲法。不过我们知道每个人有每个人的特色，不过做研究的方向都应该要这样。那么我今天以一个临床医生来跟大家介绍我在临床方面遇到问题的时候，如何从所谓的这个 critical 到bench 再回来 clinical 这个是我今天要讲。刚刚张医师也介绍，我是心脏科医生，所以我今天跟大家分享的题目是 management cardiovascular disease focus on coronary artery obstruct syndrome from practice to bench and back to practice。大家其实都很清楚，虽然说不是医生，我们知道心肌梗塞在台湾来讲，心脏病是10大死亡原因的第二。心肌梗塞呢，当然是导致最严重的住院当中我们病人的一个死亡率。那么我做这个所谓的 PIP 紧急心导管，其实我们发现心肌梗塞不单发生的频率，而且它的年纪那么随着这个时间来看，我们看到这个是我的研究发现，年轻甚至20几岁的病人都发生了心肌梗塞那么在最高峰期是在60到69岁的时候，也就是我们处在退休的状态所以说这非常值得我们注意。那么从这个我的研究的所谓的一些资料显示，男性发生心肌梗塞最多，所以男人真命苦，没有错了另外的话，在所谓的危险因子，其实在中国人里面发现到高血压跟抽烟那么是最多引起心肌梗塞的这些危险因子。所以假使你们家里面老人家有高血压或者有抽烟，请他一定要治疗或者不要再抽烟，抽烟并没有好处。那我们再来看看在心肌梗塞的时候，其实有一个是非常值得注意，就是心因性休克。在我们的研究发现呢，它是有 12.8% 这些人的死亡，那么是占所有心肌梗塞最重的一个情况。心肌梗塞发生了怎么办？当然最好的办法就快速把那梗塞的血管打通的办法有两种，一种就我们讲的紧急心导管，英文叫 Prime PCI， 另外一种就是血栓溶解剂，所谓 thrombolytic therapy 那么越来越多的研究告诉我们，两种方法都是 standard 的方法，可是 Prime PCI 跟血栓溶解剂来比较的话，那当然是 Prime PCI 能够更好、更快速来把血管打通。那么在欧洲的研究已经发现，除了好处之外，而且这病人发生心肌梗塞越早越快把血管打通是越好，所以目前我们的重症里面，我相信这边也是要跟其他医院的全台湾都鼓励所谓的多多巴论，就是说你病人发生心肌梗塞到急诊，然后到这个手术一个开始的时候，越短的时间越好，就抢哈。假使没有达到要求这个医院的可能就过不了这一关，医学中心这一关了那么这是高雄长庚医院里面一个。在高雄长庚医院里面的一个心肌梗塞，其实在1994年5月31号的时候，我们就第一个病人就发生心肌梗塞就 PIMCI。 那张医师就这边我有 那不怕坦白讲，其实高雄长庚医院啊是第一个，当初他也在第一个全台湾做 PCR 一个 leadership 最先做的哈。那么每一年心肌梗塞的病人，随着我们的经验累积的，那么在啊这个每一年当中，大概有180到200的病人接受了 PCR。那到目前为止，高雄长庚已经做了接近啊所谓的。4000多例的病人哈，整个来说应该是目前还是 leadership 的状态。那么 overall mortality 是 8.7%。那我们看看刚刚讲哈，心肌梗塞以后，假使不靠心导管手术，死亡率是80%，就看心源性休克。假如透过心导管的话，可以拉到40%。其实我们有非常 appreciate 我们这样的做法。大家注意这个分支，小于80岁跟小于65岁比较，那么死亡有天壤之别。成功，那么这个死亡降得很低。所以我们目前 focus 就这个如何把这个心导管的手术做得更好、更成功，同时呢，对这方面来下功夫来做。80岁以上的病人，到目前为止，我还想不出更好的办法来处理这些病人哈。那么随着药物的发展，还有技术方面，比如说这个叫做末端这个所谓 distal protection， 这是技术材料的话，其实处理急性心肌梗塞已经不是很困难的事，而且成绩都越来越好哈。那么这个图里面随着年纪的越高，那么死亡都越高，大家都看得很清楚。所以当我们年纪大时，我们非常小心我们的身体状况。一有什么不舒服，其实就要看心脏科张坤正医师了。OK， 那么再来我们看看，那么刚刚我们说男人命很苦，可是我们在心肌梗塞的时候，男女的分别的死亡率，竟然女性我们分析研究的结果比男性高出一倍所以我又搬了一层回来了哈。OK， 那么就算不是所谓的心因性休克的话，那么事实上。他的死亡率随着 kidney calcification 呢，那么就有这个非常不一样的表现。这个从Kaplan-Meier 的统计告诉我们的哈。那么这个我们的研究，刚刚我讲到 cardiogenic shock 这部分呢，其实是应该值得我们去处理。所以2011年，我们根据我们 database 分析发现到，假如一个病人心因性休克又发生 profound shock 的话，它的死亡率是非常高。所以根据这个多边形的一个统计发现， profound shock 是最能predict到死亡。那既然是这样，我们怎么去处理呢？那我们就这个想尽办法。所以我们的经验里面发现，假使一个病人发生这个所谓的 cardiogenic shock 心因性休克，那么又发生了所谓的更严重的 profound shock， 其实我们用叶克膜可能会提供更好的办法。那么在我的带领之下，所以我们非常辛苦也非常努力。这个例子就病人呢发生了急性心肌梗塞，来到急诊里面已经休克，那么就一路 CPR 一路把管子就导管子放进，这就是 IIPP 所谓的心脏 pump， 这个就是所谓的叶克膜哈。这样的支持之下呢，把血管打通，这个病人应该要死掉，可是他命又救回来，所以我们觉得非常值得高兴。当然用 ECMO 有很好的 teamwork 才有办法做，这个是我就做这个 cardiogenic shock 用 ECMO 和整台机器所做的其中一个情况。我们把这些病人分为两组的分析，那么假使病人发生了所谓的profound shock， 没有 ECMO， 没有那个所谓的叶克膜支持，跟有比较死亡率，其实我们看看这个是没的，这个是有的，同样 profound shock， 它的死亡率天壤之别。所以我们这篇论文发表了到那个所谓的 Kiko Care Medicine， 7年我们也受邀请到 AHA 去讲我们的经验，那么大家都非常 appreciate。终于有外国人这个 appreciate 我们中国人，所以我们也觉得非常高兴，回来坐飞机还睡不着呢。OK， 好，这个是我们分析 cardiogenic shock 的时候，确实是有 ECMO 跟没有 ECMO， 所谓的这个所谓的那个叶克膜帮忙之下，其实这 Kaplan-Meier 就看得非常清楚。 好，所以这个研究告诉我们，在心肌梗塞的时候 ，profound 这个 independent predictor for mortality 哈、哦，用叶克膜越早越好，甚至是导管是不要起，大家用叶克膜都会用，但是方法可能要想通，就是说这急诊在心导管时就要进行，通常往往这个所谓的 teamwork 也非常好，才有办法做得到这样事情。那我们认为这个 ECMO support 的话，这拯救下应该死掉的病人都能够把他的命、哦、能够拯救回来，我们觉得是、啊、非常值得推广，所以可以 routine 去、啊、用这个、啊、ECMO 来对这些病人的帮忙。后放松解决了心肌梗塞了，做的、所谓的手术做得不错，可是我们研究有发现了，在这病人存活下来啊，有17个病人 ,17% 的病人其实有明显发生心衰竭情，那就是心脏功能不好嘛。那还有三年之内也有10%死掉。这个时候我就思考、哦、到底要怎么去、啊、帮助这些病人、哦、到底怎么帮助他们才好。那么在我们思考同时，当然我们去、啊、所谓的、啊、的、啊、这个 permanent review,还有根据我们参加的 meeting 发现 stem cell 可能是个 potential， 所以这 stem cell 方面呢，那我们从 mouse、从 mouse、从 rat 还有从兔子还有从猪，这个是一个 example， 我拿出这个猪跟大家分享，我们做 stem cell 的治疗，目的就是因为猪、哦、其实它的整个构造跟人非常像，它的压力跟人的压力一样，他的心跳的重，买心脏的重量除以8地位的 ratio 跟人也一样，他的 heart rate 也一样，所以非常多，还有他冠状动脉的构造90%几都跟人一样，所以拿这个是非常能够模拟像人的，所以我们就啊来把猪，这个是蓝鱼的迷你猪，我们麻醉以后做超音波，然后从 ECRAS 里面把这些骨髓抽出来之后，我们做 stem cell culture 一个礼拜到10天以后，把数目够多的时候，我们就把这个猪麻醉插管，打开胸腔，跟心脏外科开的手术一模一样，把所谓的左前浆子找出来 ligation 之后，和从、红色的 ligation 变成、啊、黑色，然后就 EKG 呈现出来，就 ST elevation 证明、这个、心肌梗塞 model 成功，所以我们就把 stem cell 打进去。那么事实上这个是7天21天的 stem cell 的 culture 哈，我们要跑了 full site， 我们 metric 的 identification 的啊 mesenchymal stem cell surface marker 这个在呈现。那么这个这个图这个 table 告诉我们，把猪其实分了5组，为了你清楚到底 stem cell 有没有帮忙。这个是心肌梗塞没有治疗的，这个心肌梗塞治疗，可是我们 stem cell 打最被梗塞的地方，所谓的 be mulching 的 area， 就心肌梗塞打在、所谓的、infarct area。 那第四组呢完全是 same control， 可是我们给的 stem cell 治疗到底有没有 activation benefit， 也就是说是不是吃了、所谓的人假使没病的话补就更补，不知道我们试看、第五组完全 same control 没有。Initial 的 data 其实没有分别，我们看90天以后，这个所谓 LVF 就是心脏功能评估。那么在正常这两组，这有打 stem cell 没有打，其实它的心脏功能是一样的哦，所以说打 stem cell 其实没有额外的帮忙。再来的话，那么这组没有治疗跟治疗，这 stem cell 种在非 infarct area， 哎，他们之间啊、有帮忙同啊、有帮忙，但是不明显。那么到了中间 infarct area 就明显有帮了，所以我们可以看得很清楚哦。OK， 再来，那刚刚有讲哦，猪的冠状动脉的构造跟人一模一样几乎、哦，所以右边的冠状的人也有。那么假使见你除了张医师，还有别的心脏科医生就知道哦，这边是左前浆肌，左啊回旋肌，左前浆肌，我们来给手术见你，所以一系列的心啊心导管的检查。那么确实是证明我们看得到的，还有我们用 echo 来配合所谓的 angiogram 哈、哦、，F 分最不好治疗有改善，那么治疗症状更改善，之后 normal 是更好哈、哦。OK， 那么为了更 convince 人家，你到底你这个啊所谓 2D echo 有没有 bias，LV LV Engine of Advice， 好，我们就来够做 MRI。 那么目前是最能 conversion 之后有治疗跟没治疗，其实它的弊哦，硬法的弊，没治疗就薄，有治疗啊就啊厚很多。那么这个是当然是 MRI 的分子，它 wall 的 contractility 有治疗就比较好。那么还有我们就看这个所谓的 infarct transient mortality， 就是说梗塞的厚度，留下来的厚度的话，当然是啊这个所谓的啊有治疗啊比较啊 wall 比较没有那么薄，没有治疗的话那就薄。那为了更 convince 人家，我们从 pathology 来着手，看看是不是这样。所以我们把心脏切成三部分 ：apex 心尖、心中间，还有心的 basic 的地方。事实上，我们发现到从图来看，还有统计方面呢 ，wall 的 thickness 有治疗比较厚，那么表示梗塞没有那么严重。从 apical、middle、basal 里面看起来，这个 infarct area 相对性。有治疗本没治疗呢，那么减低很多，所以更证明了 stem cell 的治疗确实是有效。那我们去种 stem cell 的时候，有一种叫 DIE， 目的是 labeling 哦，三个月把猪啊嘛杀死，把东西拿下来切片，来做就 double stay merging， 这个是 troponin IV， 只要染的是心肌细胞。我们发现到大部分种进去，其实它不会变成心肌细胞，反而。这个 CD31 就是一个 endosome marker merge， 很多都、呈现出来，表示说它往 angiogenesis 方面，那个 confocal 也可以更明显看到我们种进去的一个 stem cell、啊、OK， 这个也是 confocal， 我们种进去的东西其实都留下了很最少三个月的时候，我们其实是看得到这个、中间的 stem cell 含在里面。那么我们这做一个 immunohistochemical staining， 我们说 angiogenesis 真的是这样吗？所以我们看 infarct area， 结果没有做 stem cell， 它的 number of small vessel 就所谓的 neovascularization 明显的降低，比有治疗的那两组、哦、那么就 pre-infarct area 就是梗塞周边的也是看到这种结果，所以中间 stem cell 确实是、有它的一个 angiogenesis 的一个作用。那我们用一个所谓的 Mason Tricon 来染色，到底 infarct area 里面到底的范围有多大？我们评估以后发现到，当然 normal 的当然没有很少有所谓的这个 staining 的 pores 染色的，就是哈、Mason Tricon， 那么代表是 fibrosis， 那么没治疗的哈、就最厉害，那有治疗的最 remote area 减低，那么真正。接受到 infarct area 治疗，它的就是所谓的fibrotic area 减低，那么证明我们前面所说的，那么是符合。这个是一个所谓的 MRI 来告诉我们，用 MRI 评估心脏的功能还有 stroke volume 都是有治疗的，这90天比没治疗那么还来得好，和统计方面非常有意义。那么这个是 radiology 里面玩的法式，就看这个所谓的 perfusion maximum upslope 还有 peak enhancement 都是有治疗比没治疗来的好，证明那边还有血管还有 viable 的心肌才有这种表现。那么更进一步，我们希望就 benchmark 里面看到到底含有哪些 fibrin。我们知道 stem cell 有 anti-inflammation， 还有 immunomodulation， 所以我们做了 oxidative stress， 就是 western block、哦、那么这发现这个 pre-infarct 跟 infarct area 没电。OK， 就 pre-infarct 跟 infarct area 的话。OK， 那我们就看到 oxidative stress 没治疗就非常的高，有治疗就这个拉下来哈，有治疗就拉下来。那么这个是一个mRNA 的 expression 哈 ，MMP9 也是 inflammation marker， 这有治疗跟没治疗比较，确实有治疗下来哈。我们再来看看这个是 ET Anderson dysfunction 的一个表现，那么这有治疗的时候呢，就比没治疗还来的。这个低，所以 Anderson dysfunction 应该是没治疗那一组比较高。再来我们就看看 IL-10 这个 anti-inflammation 的 biomarker 里面 最少在 mRNA expression 里面有治疗叫提升，那么它重经济的 stem cell 可能确实是有 anti-inflammation 的一个、作用、哦、好，我们来再看看 ENOS 也好 VGF 就是含有、所谓的 SDF1-alpha、还有 CXR4 这 peripheral infrared area， 其实我们都发现到在治疗以后它因为这些代表是angiogenesis expression of biomarker 里面，那么都发现有治疗有明显的一个上升的情况。那么再来 connexin 43这个 gap 增损细胞神经细胞跟神经细胞里面互相 co-communication 的话，那么没治疗就低，有治疗有上升表现、上升的现象。这个是 cytochrome C、在假使高就 cyto 的时候，你表示 mitochondria 受到 damage， 你看看这个没治疗特别高，有治疗下来，这相对性就 mitochondria 里面呢，我们看到、有治疗的它比较高，表示说比较少的 mitochondria 受到 damage。 所以我们根据我们的研究，我们总结 bone marrow stem cell implantation 就 infrared 透过 immune modulation and inflammationanti-apoptosis, anti-fibrosis 等等，还有 mitochondrial preservation， 还有 neovascularization， 还有可能有个 homing， 我们没有做到这个别的有讲。但 myogenic cell 的 definition 不多，所以我们总结应该是这样来改善我们的、心脏。好，所以对这个 study， 我们做一个、conclusion， 是从 autologous 的 boomer stem cell 的 transplantation 最重在 infra area 比non-infect area 来得好，来改善心脏功能，抑制的心脏的放大，也就是说 remodeling、透过很多的 molecular biological defense mechanism、okay。 那在这方面、我们说心肌梗塞可以考虑用 stem cell 治疗，那么事实上在临床方面我们还会发现到一些病人他没有心肌梗塞，可是他的血管是 diffuse disease， 我们给他名字叫 end stage of coronary artery disease， 他的血管从头塞到尾，你用药物治疗效果不好，你放所谓的 stent， 甚至用、这个支架网，那么撑不起来，太 diffuse 了，没有办法，用开刀也没有效。其实病人、怎么办？那么这个病人就是一样，假如说是心脏科医生，应该是非常了解这种血管是所谓的 diffuse disease， 那常常发生了 chest pain， 开刀也开过了，已经没辙了，药物也没效，没有用，这个病人怎么办呢？这个病人除了等待还是等待，他会因为心衰竭 angina 胸口痛不断去住院，不断用了劳保的费用，到最后还是走亡死亡几乎。所以我们很希望找到个 finding a safe and effective therapeutic alternative for this patient is utmost important for cardiology， 这个是我们要做的事情。怎么做？刚刚有提到 cell therapy 有没有办法，特别血管发生问题的时候，我们、stem cell 里面其中一个叫做 endothelial progenitor cell， 这个细胞本来就负责修复我们内皮细胞功能，还有、这个做 angiogenesis。 那根据我们这几年做一些、就做了、这个、很多的 stem cell 治疗，包括从 非动脉高压治疗 ischemic 治疗，还有从、所谓的、这个、AMI 的治疗等等，我们 stem cell 发现的治疗确实可以改善了 ischemia， 还有改善了心脏功能。所以我们提出一个很大胆的一个、做法，就是从、临床 preclinical 已经 shift 到要走到临床方面。那么走到临床方面有几个关卡一定要、这个有、这个一定要解决。首先你的 research 的 knowledge 够不够强，去支持你有没有这个能力去做。那第二就是势必要通过卫生署那关，所谓的 IRB 卫生署把关非常非常的严，比登天还要难。所以我们跟卫生署搏斗了两年以后，终于他同意我们做这个叫 intracoronary transfusion of autologous a CD34 cell input and function patient with diffuse coronary artery disease and non-cardiac and then candidate for coronary artery intervention， 就是说他们已经没录好，就只可能有这条路哈。那么这个计划里面希望在三年之内做完。那么我们主要呢，就是利用一种机器叫 COMET 啊 Spectra 六点，反正这个机器啊买回设定好，它就会帮我们分离 automatic 分离出来这个 CD34。当然 ，stem cell 的治疗有很多种方法。第一，最简单躲过卫生署的监控的话，就是直接拿下来，直接种进去。不经过 culture， 不经过 storage 等等，他们认为这个是最安全。到目前的话 ，culture stem cell culture 就种到啊人的身上里面，台湾最少目前没有办法，卫生署没有办法同意哈，非常非常难。所以我们选择这个逃避的办法。这个机器里面其实跟洗肾的病人其实是一样的哈，很像这台机器。这个是准备要接受。啊，所谓的 stem cell EPC 啊 ，Anderson progenitor cell EPC 的治疗哦，那么就把它的利用这机器，把这些啊这个所谓的啊 EPC 啊离心出来，那结果好像啊这个输血里面捐血的一个 back 就这边哈、哦，那么从早上八点半开始，大概中午到两点多呢，我们就可以把利用三四个小时把这些啊这个所谓的 stem cell 分离出来，这个病人。那么大家也看到整个血管都是弥漫性的堵塞，可是这沙林啊，这核磁至少没有，它是 ischemia 的情况，而且常常最痛，所以对这些病人可能这个是一个好办法。从 include 快一点，从民国100年8月，就是我们真正给卫生署堵拦到11月的时候才开始进行，我们希望这3年之内收40个病人。那么就是 stem cell 分离之后，透过我们非常专长的心导管的办法，把 microcatheter 送到我们要打的血管里面去 injection， 让这些 stem cell 呢能够 coating 在本来受损的血管，也就 endothelium cell dysfunction。到这个临床医生的一个啊这个 criteria， 我们今天就不再跟你讲，因为他有点心胸痛等等，还有意愿进入这个 study 哈。那当然我们做一个 study 一定有全面性的一些 image study basic， 包括心电图啊、超音波啊、核磁所扫描来证明卡的 MI 证明确实治疗有改善、哦、那么初步的结果目前为止我们做到第15个，那当然还有要、走下去，有些病人在追踪啊，这个时间还不够长，所以这个基本的 data 是这样。其实这些病人都年纪很大哦，糖尿病有非常多，肾功能也不好，那么又开过刀，所以每心脏有三条血管，血三、血二、血三，就表示有三条、两条血管，全部都是多重性的血管堵塞哈。哦那我们在一个 flow cytometry 去看看 CD34 的表现，所以我们治疗也为了希望我们的stem cell 所谓的 EPC 在血中能够数量更高，那我们就用 GCSF 给它治疗3天之后把这个 stem cell 赶出来，所以我们就血液中的所谓 circulation 我们就看得到有打 GCSF 跟打完以后事实上它的数目增加了，那么再来我们搜在那个 back 看到 concentrate 它的数目会更高、哦、好，这个病人是一个患例，我们把 stem cell 收回了，我们就开始进行到导管去治疗，这个是一个过程。为了知道到底这个 stem cell 打到冠状动脉它到底怎么走向，所以我们在这个 coronary sinus 就是冠状动脉回流的静脉里面放过 catheter， 这个当医师就非常清楚这个方法、哦、所以我们把这些细胞根据时间来收、哦、大家一定会问你打这个 stem cell 会不会跑到别的地方很少流失，可是我们这 basic research 的 study 里面我们发现到肾跟 liver 是最容易 tracking stem cell， 但是受损之后呢它也很容易 stem cell EPC stem cell 跑里面去、哦、所以我们用 penis 打进去这个扔 IR 之后呢 stem cell 其实自然就跑那边，这个肺动脉高压我们用静脉打进去它自然就倒了受损 engorgement 就是那个受损的血管，这个是 kidney IR 我们也看到、哦、kidney 受损以后 Steam 这样从静脉打，他就跑到那边。这个老鼠是一个 muscular dystrophy， 我们怀疑可能 endothelium 也受损。哎，结果我们都没有做什么治疗，我们从 penis V 打进去，自然就跑到那些脚里面。所以我们目前正在研究，到底是因为这样，而是的话，是不是 Steam 这样治疗对他是有帮忙哈？OK， 那这个是我们从这个 circulation 里面来看EPC， 这个白色的是还没有打 GCF， 那黑色是打完以后，所以是它的不同种类的 stem cell 事实上都有增加。这个图就刚告诉我们，从没有打这个 stem cell， 只有没有打 EPC endothelium progenitor， 就内皮干细胞中文哈，我们看打完五分、十分、三十分，我们最 concern 的是冠状动脉静脉，我们一起去追踪它的这个EPC 的流量 ，shedding 的流量，其实的趋势有在增加，不是一下子就跑掉。这个是不同的这个所谓的那个 EPC 的 mark 或打前打后，确实上它增加数目是有明显的。就是我们对于每个病人，我们都做所谓的那个culture， 最做 angiogenesis metric check 看。这个年纪大的人，哎，没有打 GCS 以前他不长，打完以后他长。这个是第二个年轻一点。没打以前都有涨，可打完有涨的更多，所以你会，我们将来把 data 分析以后，我们可能从里面会找到一些那很有趣的一个表现。那目前 data 正在分析哈，那么因为病人也不够，我们从心脏我们最 concern 说，到底你这样治疗有没有效？所以我们很 concern 就是 image 的 study， 2D echo 里面打的时候事前是 45%， 打完以后一个月有增加一点。那么三个月后也有增加，那只有我们追踪到六月。那么为了那个的话，我们也做 3D， 也发现有这个倾向，还有 MRI， 今天的 data 还不够完整，所以没办法 show 出来哈。所以我们做一个 conclusion， 就是 intracoronary transfusion of autologous EPC for diffuse coronary artery patient 是安全的还是 efficacy。跟 optimal dose， 我们还要做一个追踪哈，最 final result。假设有兴趣，两年以后，那么我们也会做一个报告。所以我今天要跟大家讲哦，那么就是从一个临床医师如何去临床发现问题，跑回去 benchmark， 那 benchmark 找到答案的时候，我们尝试追回到 clinical 来治疗病人，就是临床医生应该要做的事情，这样才有办法来帮助病人。当然一个人做不了大事，一定有很多很多的人来帮忙，所以我感谢我的 teamwork 里面有不少很多的人来贡献他的一份力量，才有今天小小一点成绩。谢谢大家。
我们谢谢叶医师非常精彩的演讲，那请大家这个时候可以有一些问题来跟他请教，或者是 comment。来，
叶师真的是非常 huge 的 team 哦。那我想叶师真的是他的 contribution 真的非常大，他甚至在长庚我知道他组织一个读书会，那住了一个 apartment， 所有的医师呢晚上都在那边一起读 paper， 那我觉得实在是非常非常 impressed。 那我好奇是说，好像刚才打这个 stem cell 到 infra 跟非 infra 的地方，好像是当然是 infra 的地方比较好，那证明出来都是 angiogenesis 的 involved， 那会不会说实际上在 infra 这边不只是 angiogenesis， 实际上还有其他的 factor 在造成？
对，目前越来越多的证据，包括我们的证据，就是显示stem cell 的治疗有几个角色。第一，我们比较不相信是 differentiation， 比如说你打 stem cell 进去它会产生心肌细胞，然后就做作用。目前这条路不太行。那么其他，但是为什么我们临床看到一个结果有真好了？那么为什么又认为 stem cell 没有 differentiation， 说的应该有 confound 的哦？我们去找别人去找，我们发现到目前为止哦，应该有几个情况。第一就是 angiogenesis， 第二就是 parkin effect， 第三可能。stem cell 中间是越来越证据发现它 homing 扶贫患有， 就是蜜蜂就很远的地方发现有蜂蜜的话，它会放一些 enzyme 叫远的蜜很远的蜜蜂过来一起来分享哈、哦。当然，那么含有的其他的，比如说细胞最心肌细胞每个 organ 最 ischemia 药哦，它的 infarct 时候，它走的路就是 necrosis 或者 apoptosis， 这些都受到 oxidative stress 还有 inflammation 的影响。STEM 项目前已经发现，除了刚刚所讲，它有 anti-inflammation， 还有 immunomodulation， 也就是 lowering 的这个所谓 immunogenicity。所以我想从这些角色来推测 ，STEM 项的治疗可能是一个 pleiotropic effect， 不单是用一个 mechanism 能够解释它的问题。
哎、
okay.
吴老师。
叶医师，非常感谢你哈，在临床的工作这么 heavy loading 的情况之下，还能够有这么样子丰硕的一些成果，而且还要其实持续的做下去。那我们 expect 在两年之后能够看到你非常好的一些成就哈。那我想请教一下，就您刚刚在讲到这个 EPC 的这个 therapy 的时候哈，让我想到说，其实，在临床上面在做这些支架的放置哈，其实产生很多的这些 restenosis 的问题。那这个 restenosis 有一些部分认为都是因为在 endothelium 被 degeneration 之后，然后引起后面很多的这些 smooth muscle cell 的 proliferation。 那如果刚刚您提到这个 EPC 的这样子 homing 的一个结构，我在想说有没有可能在这个支架方面呢，能够放一些什么样的东西，假设我们知道说有个 homing 的 signal 在那地方，那 coating 在这个支架上面，然后让这一些 EPC cell 能够跑到这个支架方面去，那这样子会对这些 restenosis 的问题会不会有所改善？
非常谢谢你问的好问题，也是我们在思考。事实上，我们知道支架要肌肉扩张术之后导致 restenosis 很多 mechanism。刚刚你也提到啊，这个所谓的 smooth muscle proliferation。那 smooth muscle proliferation 理论上就主要还是因为 endothelium cell 没有 coating， 就是什么，而且 defect。所以没有产生这 NO nitric oxide 等等，而且说更多的 episomoic 跑进来。那么因为这样的话，那大家都在想，其实生意人就是那些做所谓的生意的人，而且那个其他其实老早就想这个问题，当我们发现这个问题，他就想得到去进行了。那么有时候我们发现了 theoretical 很好，可是 practical 可能还有一些 defect 没有拎起来。那么事实上 STEM cell 现在在支架里面呢，已经有一些 coating 的 STEM cell 在里面了。那么结果呢，特别是做这 MIT clinical trial， 结果做起来，跟有 coating 没 coating 其实没有多大的分别。所以这个问题在哪里，我们就思考。那么第二的就是STEM cell 在 EPC 里面不是全部好的EPC， 有可能坏的 EPC 里面呢，它可能就会做一些逆向而行哈、比如说肺动脉高压的时候，最后那个所谓的 atherosclerosis 或者 obstruction 的这个 type 的时候，其实还是有些打不死的那个 STEM cell 最造反，所以变成是 proliferation。就如同刚刚郑教授讲，一个血管里面呢，除了内皮还有 smooth muscle，千万不要忘记 Avascis 那边其实有很多的 STEM cell， 包括 endothelium cell 里面，其实它扮演角色，有时候跟 atherosclerosis 有关系，并不是正向，而是反向的反向。所以到目前为止，这个理论是很好，但是还没有解。我相信还有一些 gap， 假使郑教授能够去这方面研究，帮助我们临床，冠教授帮助我们临床的话，我觉得应该很快就过解冠。
这是方面的专家哈，就是说我们在用 drug eluting stent 的时候，我们看到说大概10%的病人会 restenosis， 可是90%人是不会有这些问题哈。那这个情况是怎么样子一个因素？因为我想在临床医师在这方面的技术应该不会有太大的差异哈。所以，但是在 in general overall 来讲的话，只有10%的会产生这些问题，那另外那90%却是不会哈。所以我说有没有哪一些 factor 它可能是参与说？造成这些病人比较容易产生 restenosis 的问题。
我先不客气讲，临床医生其实他的经验有好有坏。对对，确实是这样哈、 OK， 因为一个血管里面哦，假如说你放了 stent， 会发生 restenosis， 有非常多的 factor。第一个，放进的 stent 有没有贴到壁？哦，假使经验不够，而且说会怕啊，这个啊血管撑太大的时候会 rupture 的时候，他们就会保守。保守的时候，特别是血管通常堵塞的地方 ，atherosclerosis 就等于那个。啊，墙壁凹凸不平。假使你没有 optimal 把这个所谓的 stent 张开来的话，那么也就是透过所谓的 high pressure 的话，你贴不好，这种就是一个 restenosis 的一些情况。第二的话，那我们发现到肾脏病、洗肾的病人、糖尿病人，他就算有 stent drug eluting stent 进去的时候。它的 smooth muscle 还是容易 proliferation， 所以这个又是一组会发生啊血管啊这个所谓的堵塞，还有一些就是血管太小，我们知道血管放了支架网以后，它多少都 proliferation， 假使血管够大的话，你 proliferation 的东西不多的话，它的 luminal area 哦还是够的哈。那么假使说他的血管很小的话，你放个 drug eluting stent 本来 lumen 就不大，又长了东西以后就把它塞死了、哦、还有血管 long diffuse 很长的、哦、很长的话，那你放了支架网，它将来的 restenosis 也是大。所以总而言之，还有一个 genetic 的问题，我们都没有办法啊预估得到，就要研究。还有一些人哦，对于所谓的抗血小板的药物有 resistant， 所以放完以后。那么这样的结果也可能导致 thrombosis 和 stenosis、哦、那么这个是目前我们看得到的一些问题就对了，就导致、stent with stenosis， 就算现在最好的 drug eluting stent 还是有堵塞的机会。
因为那个现场很多的学生、啊、
对，
我稍微提一个非学术的问题、
啊、好，
你不要见怪因为大家看到那个叶医师，虽然他现在好像这个研究做得相当不错、哦、那可是他当时在那个飞龙快要升主治医师的时候，差一点升不上去啊、哦、那可是靠着他的努力啊，其实叶医师他是没有假日的，他礼拜天也不休息了。我想说，因为有他这样的这个努力，所以克服了很多的困难，所以今天可以看到那么好的成果。给那个同学做参考。那另外的话，在学术上，我有两个问题请教你哈。你现在用的这个在心肌梗塞之后打入 CD34 的这个 model， 那事实上跟那个 Texas Heart Institute Dr. Ye 他们所用的这个方法是比较接近。那不晓得你这两个有什么不同哈？那另外第二个问题就是，另外在美国加州的西达塞奈，也就是我的老师啦 ，Dr. Marvin， 他用的是那个 cardiac stem cell， 好、哦，那也是取自这个病人自己的心脏，那他把那个 endogenous 的 cardiac stem cell 分离出来，然后再打回去。那据他的那个 finding 的话，他是从 coronary artery 打进去以后呢，那个 stem cell 会 retention 在 heart。非常的少，那我不晓得你也是从那个 coronary 打进去，不晓得你的这个 retention rate 怎么样？谢谢。
好，我回答第一个问题，有稍微解释一下啊。事实上，我用stem cell 来打 infarct 是猪，用人呢是内皮干细胞 endothelial stem cell 硬。血管 diffuse disease， 所以不是用 endothelium progenitor 打到那个 infarct、哦、那我们的想法是一个血管受损以后，其实它 call for help， endothelium defects 它可能会释放一些求救的信号，包括 epithelial molecule 等等。我们认为这些 stem cell 可能会往有病的血管去进行，所以是不是这样就 epithelium 就那边，那么这是我们期待看到的情况，这个是我们 theoretical 去想、哦、那么事实上到目前为止、哦、说老实话，最做 stem cell 的 route 路途、哦、怎么去给、哦、那么有很多的路途，在把 stem cell 打到血管里面，目前对心脏这样分类所的，其实可能是 比较相对性没有直接 implant 到心脏里面来的哈，我是同意这样，而且打到冠状动脉大部分都流失掉哦。那我不知道用 cardiomyocyte 跟那个 Anderson progeny 有可能不一样，因为 Anderson progeny 的时候，我们目的是用的 coating 就 diffuse 的冠状动脉，还有最 capillary 里面 capture 它。capture 的，我们的理论是刚刚根据我们做 animal model， 但是 cardio stem cell 从这边打进去，我是认为假使说他的老师当初有我们一起讨论，我是认为种进去比打进去可能还有办法把这 cardio stem cell retention， 因为打进去的 cardio cell 已经没有着力点，可能很快流失，我推测其中一个原因可能是这样。当然假使你把希望这个 cardiac stem cell 能够发挥作用，可能 implant 的机会比较好。不过大家都知道 implant 讲得很简单，只有个英文字，可是做起来非常痛苦。为什么？首先你要假使是人的话，住很好 ，on end 打开就好哈。死掉我们就难过些子，因为投资很多本钱。可是人不行，万一他死掉非常惨哦，所以这个冒很大的 risk， 而且还有外科医生整个involve 进去哦，所以种进去以后，可能check 看你的量，那么可能要 induce 这 VTVF 等等都有可能，就是我们非常 concern， 也是卫生所不允许我们做的一个其中一个原因。将来我相信会找到更好的路。总而言之 ，stem cell 是一个非常 potential， 看我们如何去研究，如何发展。这个 stem cell 的研究可能还有蛮长的路要走，谢谢。
OK， 谢谢。好，谢谢医师。